Hi, greetings from TRX Bench. Do you like classic radios like me? All the old styles, these radios with flair and with a kind of soul, like the Legions, maybe Cobra GTL 148 or the Cobra GTL 2000, or maybe a European one, a Grundig CBH-100 or Kaiser or what have we. So these radios are great, and that was the time of CB radios in general. Well, but these days there are retro style radios on the market already. And now, if you like radios like this, we have a new star here. And that is the new Albrecht AE7500. So this radio is really claiming to be a modern radio in a real nice vintage style. And that is what we want to look over today. We want to check if this radio is promising too much, or if this really could be a successor of all the Cobras or heavy on the market. So let's right go onto the bench and let's see what this radio is, shall we? And this radio was already announced last year, but they had some difficulties and they were obviously not able to ship, but now they are available and you really can buy them. And yeah, if you right look here onto the box, you find the information. It is a CB radio or an amateur radio. And if we look onto this here, you see it can be prepared as a CB radio or as amateur radio. And that is a kind of really nice construction. So this radio has really a broad or wide use, so that is really nice. And well, so this radio seems to be, or could be a hero. And yeah, so therefore we perform some lab tests today, and we want to see how this radio really performs. And yeah, I'm really excited, and let's right go into the box opening, and after that we directly start with our lab tests and see how this radio performs. Okay, so let's see what we have here in the box. And that is tight. I can't really get it out. Oh, very, very tight. So, not so easy. But finally, here it is. Okay. So we have our user manual, for sure. So this is in German, English, France, Italian, and in Spanish. Very nice. And yeah, we have here our car installation kit. And this is as well what you need to put it in your car. And of course, have a look. So here we have the new Albrecht AE7500. So this, you know, I can't help myself, but I really like this design. So that is really, really, that is a burner. Okay, so what do we have else? So somewhere we should have a mic.
And of course, here is our microphone, and it looks like the standard microphones. They have already very long in their portfolio, so that is nothing special, but they are not too bad. And here's our power cord, so that is what we have in the box. Okay, and first impression, here the build quality seems to be good, so everything looks quite nice, and all the switches and pots are working just fine, so you do not have the feeling that it is a kind of sheep. Here the pressing points are okay as well, and the finish is okay. Maybe here a little bit a damage on the... No, it's no damage. It was just a bit dirt. So everything seems to be fine. And well, we have here a label. So it must have been a quality check, and telling us passed on RX and TX. Okay, we have here a very nice heat sink. I mean, if it is used as amateur radio, so this radio is putting out, I don't know, we will find it out, 30 watt or so, and of course therefore you need a bigger heat sink, so maybe that is not sufficient enough, so maybe that you better have a fan additional if you run this radio as amateur radio. And yeah, then we have of course an external speaker jack, and we have a key jack, and of course our antenna connector, and here our power cord. And we have here a sticker which is telling us how to adjust all the different, how to access the different country codes. And you see we really have here different different settings. That is because we have different laws in the different countries in Europe, so therefore you really need to set your radio to the legal setting which is valid in your country, and therefore we have all these settings, and this sticker is telling how to access and how to adjust it. And of course, it is an AM, FM and SSB shortwave radio. And yeah, so that is what you need if you want to take part in the game. But now let us connect it to the power supply. Let's fire it up and let's see how it looks like. Okay, so let's fire the radio up and let's see how it looks like. So here we are. Very nice blue display. So let's see if it is already the European setting with 80 channels. And yes, it is. So this is already set to D4, so that is what the manual is telling us. And yeah, very nice. So that is what we have. Looks really, really nice, no doubt. Okay, and well, you know, basically this radio looks very similar to the Albrecht Ultraforce. So The only thing must be that they changed the electronic design. Maybe that they improved the quality, but I presume it is much more for reducing costs to produce these radios cheaper. So that is most likely the target they have, and that is the aim to reduce costs. So that is what it is all about all the time with new consumer electronic. But as I already said, it looks really very similar to the old Albrecht UltraForce. Yeah, just to compare it a little bit. So this is here the Ultra or UltraForce. So that is a former model, and design-wise, it is really very, very similar. So they changed a little bit the functions of here our buttons. So for instance, this here you can switch to SWR, to shortwave, and such, and that is different with the new 7500. So there we have only the automatic squelch switch sitting, but other than that, it is very much similar. And when we go through the different pictures, so we recognize that it is really, it is almost the same radio. So the difference only can be with the electronic circuit design. So that is all what I can imagine, but we will find out. Well, the radio is really equipped with almost everything what has been done in the past to the old Cobras with mods. So, for instance, I mean, it is not important, but, well, it is like... Now that is a Roger beep, so you can switch on and off a Roger beep, and you can change the backlight color, so to the color you really like. You can switch it off as well, and you know that is very much what has been done in the past with modifications. We have seen a lot of nice Cobras which got a new background illumination, and that makes it a little bit individual, and that is already built in. And as well, you can switch on and off the beep, for instance, and you can see it here with this icon on the right hand side. So that is all. That is all be accessed via program, and Roger beep. So that is indicated here. So, and that is again the backlight. So you see a lot of stuff. So it is really loaded with a lot of stuff, this radio. Of course, there are as well some nice functions like this LCR, which is last channel recall. So that is sometimes very convenient. And this radio has also an echo mod, so that has been done, or talk back. For instance, here 1 2, let me check it. 1 2 1 2 1 2. Yeah, so you see, we have a talkback function already included, and that is what has been implemented in the past with all the Cobras. Yeah, you already recognize I really love the old Cobras, so therefore, you know, that is really nice. And You have also, that is a clarifier, and you have a delay. I don't know if we can hear the delay here on the talkback as well. No, not really, but it is definitely to be heard on the band. And we have a tone adjustment, and here our output power adjustment, and that, yeah, that is squelch for sure. Here we have a RF gain pot, and yeah, that is mic gain. So we can adjust the mic gain, and this here is our automatic squelch, and we can switch it off, and we can switch to PA. But therefore, you definitely need an external speaker. Then you can switch the radio to a power amplifier. So that is an audio power amplifier, I believe. And yeah, that is that was present in old radios as well. So that is nothing new. The echo, the echo switch is here, and here is a mod switch. So that is for FM, AM, and upper and lower sideband. So that is placed here. And of course, you have here as well a noise blanker function, which can be set via the function button, and you can then read it here in the upper right top of our display. So there are really a lot of nice functions which are already implemented. So yeah, it is a full load of all nice and needful functions, and some gadgets, or however you call it. So it is really a pretty nice outfit. Yeah, and again, if you compare the Cobra 148F GTL DX, then you see this is really the radio with frequency counter and everything. So the AE7500 seems to be the successor, or try to follow this radio concept. And you see that as well, the push buttons and what have we are very, very similar to what we have here on the bench today. Yeah, and in Europe it is really important that all these radios have FM. So FM is the most used mode in Europe, so it is completely different to the US, where we still AM and SSB is used, and that is the reason why you always find the nice old Cobras and maybe especially the Cobra 2000, GTL 2000, which has only what means only. So this radio has AM and SSB on board. And you know, it makes sense to customize and rebuild these radios because you can still use them. So you have your 40 channels or what you are using in the US, and yeah, in Europe it is rather different. So we really do not have a radio which really can be used if you like to stay legal, because in the past we started with AM radios, and we only had 12 channels, and yeah, so it was a kind of development over the years, and therefore you do not really find nice old radios which are still in use, because if you once touch the radio, you really lost directly your certification so your type approval is lost directly, so you can't use it any longer, even if you give your radio in an approved and certified radio shop from the manufacturer. Even then it is not possible to modify, for instance, an old CB radio which has only 12 channels, so you can't upgrade them to 40 channels, and you can't upgrade the former half watt legal power output to 4 watt legal power output. If you do it, you directly lose your type approval, and that is why you do not find the old nice radios in Europe. So yeah, you really need to buy a new radio if you like to get all the new features, and if you like to stay legal, then that is the only chance you have. And therefore, yeah, this radios have their right, I would call it, okay? Yeah, and you guys in the US really have a radio history, and it is worse to upgrade and to customize and to pimp your old radios. And yeah, what you see here, that is the internet site from my friend Tim from Snake Radio Customs, and you really should have a look onto his site if you are living in the US, because he is really doing an amazing job. So what he is doing to all the old radios, and it is not only to customize the front and the LCD, LED and what have you, and the background, so you can see it here by the Cobra 2000. So he is really upgrading the radio with new capacitors inside, and upgrading wires, and removing stuff which is not really working any longer after 40 years of usage or such. So I really can recommend you just visit Tim on his internet site, and he has as well a very nice YouTube channel, Snake Radio Customs, and there he shows what he is really doing to all these nice old radios. And yeah, therefore in the US you really can do your upgrade to your old radios, which is not possible in Europe if you want to stay legal. Okay, and we start now with our lab test. First of all, we start with our receiver test, and then we go through all the functions. Okay, first of all, we do a sweep test, just to get a feeling what the input impedance is. As we know, it should be around 50 ohm, or with other words, we should have always SWR from 1 to 1, which is not always given, but we want to see the radio to be more or less in the specs, so it should really not be worse than, let me say, 3 to 1. And that is what we're gonna test right now. So what you hear here is a sweep, which is going over the entire band. And let's see how it looks like on the graph. Okay, and that is a sweep. And what we can see here is from... this is here marker 1, and it starts at 24,800, goes up to 27,584 with marker 2, and we see here in this area we are below, yeah, a little bit above 3, but all in all it is working just fine. If I now play with my RF gain, so that is what I'm doing right now. You see, we are losing receive sensitivity. Yeah, that is clear. When we play with RF gain, and you directly see how the reaction is here on the graph. So our return loss is getting worse. So that is what we very often see. And well, when I now start changing the frequency, you see that the graph is moving a little bit. No. So that is what we can see as well. Yeah, it is moving, which it should, because yeah, we want to have a changing impedance over the received frequencies, so that is working as well. I mean, this is always a very critical parameter in any kind, so it is not really easy to get real matching input for a radio, for a consumer radio, because to get a much better impedance, so that really means a lot of development, a lot of stuff which needs to put into radio to be really on the required impedance. But for this radio, it is all working as it should, and so we do not really have any complaints, so that is okay. Okay, so the next what we check is the S meter accuracy, and radio is set to a level of S9, and you see the reading is not too bad. So this is here our RF gain pot, and it is clear that when we change it, that we have an impact of our S meter. Now it is fully sensitive, and we see it is reading with minus 73 dBm. It is reading S9, which is fine. I just want to see how it is reacting if we read minus 85 dBm, which is this, and minus 85 dBm would mean a level of S7, and we see here a significant drop, and that means even the S7 level is not even possible to display in the right way. So that means this S meter is not really helpful, because it really drops very easily to, what is it right here, S1, which should display S7 level. And yeah, that is a little bit disappointing. Anyways, we can read a good S9 level, but beside an S9 level, you know, it is quite difficult. Okay, so next is we are interested in the sensitivity, and first of all, the SINET with minus 73 dBm is 30.6, so that is for a CB radio or a low-cost ham radio receiver, it is just okay. So we have seen even more worse receivers, which are around 24. And this is at 30 with our SINET, and well, okay, not too bad. But I'm now interested where we are at 12 dB SINET, because that is a level which is described in the manual, and there we should see a certain input level, which is then the sensitivity. And therefore, let me here simply reduce our input signal until we reach here 12 dB. And now this is the squelch. Squelch is back in. It's now out. Sorry. And we want to see 12 dB. And you already hear there is now noise, which is okay. But we can go even lower. Now we are approaching our 12 dB, which is, yeah, it is jumping, which is normal because it is a very low signal right now, and I would say it is approximately 12 dB. And now I switch here my value to microvolt because the level is given here in microvolt in our documentation. So let me double check what it is. Well, and this value is a little bit disappointing, so let me turn down here the tone. And what we can read here is 0.441 microvolt, and that is not what our documentation or specs is telling us. So let me see if I can bring it here in front. Okay, so we are looking for FM sensitivity, and that should be better than 0.3 microvolt for 12 dB. And as you can see it here on our display, it is not 0.3, so that is even worse. So therefore, yeah, let me go down here to 0.3, which we have approximately here, and you see now the radio is only able to peak maybe 8 dB synod, so maybe less. So you see that is a little bit unexpected. I thought that it is really in spec, but it does not really look like this. So that is a little bit disappointing. I'm testing on channel 80, which is 26955 megahertz, so that is the frequency, and that is right in the middle of the entire band. So therefore, let us check the figures. If I move into let me go to channel 18 maybe, so that is 27.175 megahertz, and now we are on 27.175. And it is not channel dependent, obviously. So even with this changed frequency, we have still not our expected synod value. So okay, let me go up to channel 40, just in case, which is 27.405 megahertz. And let me hear. Yeah, we have our signal. So now we are at the band edge of the upper channel, so 27405 is the highest available CB radio frequency, and even there we are not able to meet the 300 micro, 0.3 micro volts, which is 300 nanovolt, by the way. But anyways, the radio is not able to really fulfill this figure. So that is really disappointing. But anyways, there is another value which is given, and that is telling us that the, how do they call it, hang on, so the minimum signal which could be read should be minus 135 dBm. So let me switch it back to dBm. Let me hear our speaker, and yeah, we can hear the tone for sure. Now let me go to 135, and you already hear, maybe here with minus 122 you are able to read the signal, but going down here to 35, so that is simply not true. There we only have static, and we definitely do not see a signal at all. So that is definitely not true, and that is here the level where we can hear a little bit in the background. And that is very easy to see here on our hang on a second, that is very simple to see here on the spectrum as well. So this here is an NF spectrum, and you see here this is a 1 kilohertz peak, and if I go down to 135, as they are claiming in the manual, you do not see nothing. So you only see noise. So that is a horrible signal to noise level. There is no signal anymore. And when I now go back here to the point, and now you see the signal is coming up here out of the noise. And of course, when I go up, you definitely see the signal, and you see the improving signal to noise ratio. And let me go here maybe up to minus 73. So now I'm back to 70, minus 73, which is an S9 level, and you really see a very much improved signal to noise ratio. And so the noise is down, and you definitely see our signal. And again, if I go here back to to 12 dB Senet, which is approximately here, you see, of course, we have a reduced signal to noise ratio, that is sure. And this here, by the way, are the distortions. So that are the harmonic distortions, which you can see here. And so therefore, the radio is not really giving us the figures which are written down in the documentation. So there, I have to say, the radio is out of spec. Well, now I'm testing on SSB, a radio set to upper sideband, and here we have a different situation. So what you can find here with 250 nanovolt, so we are already peaking 17 dB Senet, which is better than the specs, so we could go down, let me say, to 10, because that is what they are claiming. And yeah, let me remind you, the CINET value is not only signal to noise, but it is also the distortion. And if with the CINET level we are much better than the specs, then it is really good, because here the specs are only talking about signal to noise. And you see, with 10 dB CINET, maybe a bit better, but anyways, we are down to 119 nanovolt, and that is completely different in this regards. And it is from that perspective, it is really good, so we can't complain. So this radio is definitely better on SSB receive than on FM. So something is wrong with FM receive. Maybe that the alignment is not really good, so that the radio needs to be realigned. But you know, that is not what I would expect from a radio like this, because the majority of us are not able to realign a radio, because that really requires some knowledge and some lab equipment. So that is really disappointing, and these radios are most likely used on FM. So I would say for more than 90% these radios are used on FM, and therefore once again that is disappointing. But on the other hand, here on SSB our receiver is working better than in the specs, and that is on the other hand very much in the specs and even better. Yeah, just to show you the spectrum display as well. So we are still at down at 119 nanovolt, which is really very low. So that is minus 125.5 dBm. So that is really a low level. And here we can clearly see our fundamental radio is slightly off, so normally we should read here 1 kilohertz, but it is 1.021, so radio is 21 hertz off. So my Rohde and Schwarz is reporting exactly the same. So our frequency is off a little bit, but that is something we're going to check later on transmit, how far it is off on transmit. And you can see here my signal to noise level. So signal to noise is still 12.5, and once again that is not the CINET what we are reading here. So that is really signal to noise, and we are above the required 10 dB. So we can clearly say that our SSB receiver is nice and sensitive, and it is really working as it should. Okay, radio is back to FM, and I'm now interested in our filter width. So this will be the filter width measurement, so to identify how wide or narrow our IF filter is here for FM. And yeah, therefore let me start the routine to be able to measure our filter width. And now radio has started the routine, and we should read here if it is ready. We should see the filter width, and we should see the delta from the middle of the filter. And you see radio is working, and here we are. So our filter width is 8.8 kilohertz, and we are 400 hertz off from the middle, so that is not too bad. And this filter is fine, so that is approximately 9 kilohertz width, so that is more than good for our 10 kilohertz steps we have here with our CB channels. So I'm quite satisfied here with 8.8 kilohertz, and as well with our delta from the middle of the IF filter. So that is good, and so this test is passed. Okay, radio is back to SSB upper sideband, and I'm now interested what the filter width will be on SSB. So now the test procedure is a bit different. So we need to find the minus 6 dB point at the edges of the filter, so at the lower end and at the upper end. And therefore I go and will change then here the frequency, and so the tone will be different. So for the moment in time we are right more or less in the middle of our filter. And what I'm gonna do is I'm checking where we have our minus 6 dB point. And let me show you how I'm gonna do this. Okay, so therefore I put my little audio analyzer here to the radio, and you can still hear the tone, which should be 1 kilohertz. So we can check it, by the way. And you see here we have again our 21 hertz off, so that is what we have already seen on our spectrum. Anyways, so with this 1 kilohertz we see that we have 426 millivolt. And so that is not so important. More important is to say that this level will be 0, right? 0 dB. And therefore we simply go here to 0, and I tell the meter that this will be 0. And you see now the meter has zeroed the value. So now we are reading 0.00. So these two figures are behind the dot is fine. Maybe I simply reduce the digits to this here, then it is easier to see. And now I'm gonna change my generator frequency, and while changing the generator frequency we are moving within our passband filter, and I want to see the edges of the passband filter, and we write down then the frequencies which are corresponding with our minus 6 dB, and then we find the lower end and we find the upper end of our curve, and so then we can calculate our filter width. Okay, so let me start and let me go down with the frequency, and you already see that the dBs are falling, and as I said, I'm interested in the minus 6 dB point. I have to go slowly because I'm already approaching my 6 dB level. And here we are. So let's see what we have there. So that is 205. Let me write down 205.3 maybe. So that is the lower frequency. And now we have to go the other way around. So we go up and we will see where we have our upper end. And therefore, of course, I'm now increasing the frequency, and you can, of course, see that now we are already over our 27.206, and we're going up, and you see that we are already on the falling edge. So let me see. Again, we have to go slowly, right? We have to go slowly up to the point where we meet our minus 6. And that is where we meet our minus 6 dB, back here to our frequency display, and we can read 27.207.91 megahertz. And now, by calculating the delta from this upper frequency and the lower frequency, we can simply determine the SSB filter width, right? Yeah, and if we do the math on these two frequencies, right, we simply find that our filter width is 2.6 kilohertz. And that is very nice, because that shows me that this radio has a dedicated filter for SSB. Because that was very often a problem in the past, because the radio manufacturers use the same filter for FM and for SSB, for the first SSB radios, CB SSB radios, which were on the market. And then we had very easily a filter width of 10 kilohertz or such, or even more. And that simply doesn't make any sense. And now, with this test, we see that now they are obviously using really SSB filter, and we have a filter width of 2.6 kilohertz, which really makes sense, because we really do not need a wider filter than this. So this is really great, and I appreciate it that they are really using SSB filter. So that is really good. And maybe it is because this radio is also sold as amateur radio, because with an amateur radio it wouldn't be I don't know, so that wouldn't be simply a joke if there is not a dedicated filter, right? And just to give you an impression, so this is here our fundamental, which is at 2.934 kilohertz, which is of course our upper frequency, where we are at our minus six dB level, you remember, right? And I just wanted to show you what is happening when I'm reducing here my frequency. So you can now see here our fundamental moving, and here is our 1 kilohertz point where we started off, and we went even deeper to the lower end where we have our minus 6 dB level. And you can again then reading this frequency, right, which is, you can really read it down here. Okay, so I'm at minus 8, so I have to really to go to minus 6 dBm, which is somewhere right here. And you see it is at 338 hertz, which makes sense. Okay, so that really makes sense, and that is more than good. So I'm quite happy with this finding, so that is quite good. So let's go ahead. Okay, next step will be our audio clipping. First of all, let's see what the manufacturer is claiming in the data sheet. And they are claiming that the audio output will be with 2 watt into 8 ohm, maximum 7% THD, and I believe this is 7% THD plus noise. Here we have already our 2 watt, because I'm now putting the audio output into a dummy load of 8 ohm, and 8 ohm dummy load with 4 volt, which it is here already. Let me check. 4 volt. We need 4 volt output power, which it is. We should have less than 7 dB, 7% THD, and that is what we want to see. And we can confirm it, because our THD is definitely below 7%, so we only have 2.6% THD, and that is what we can see here on the screen. Our sign is still very nice and clear, and even the tone is sounds really like a clean sign, so everything is fine. And let us now go up to the clipping. Let me do it here a little bit a different setting, and now let's go up until we reach the point, and we are already at the point, so we are really at this border where we go into the clipping. So you can definitely see it better this way here. Let me see where we can see it best. And so you definitely see that is the clipping, the clipping voltage, and it is 4.27 volt. So that means a bit about 2 watt audio output, and the clipping is reached with, let me double check here, our clipping starts so we can clearly see it, and with that we have then 4.3 percent THD, and when I now go ahead, you see that the THD is increasing like hell. That is what you can of course see here at our scope screen. So this is not a sign anymore, so it is more something different, but not a sign. So if I go back until the point where a sign is still a sign, and that is really 4 volt, which means 2 watt. So that is really nice. So we definitely can say that finally the audio amplifier, or let me say the entire audio stage, is really working just fine. So that is no problem whatsoever. Yeah, and just to see here the spectrum, and this is now just below the clipping where the audio amplifier starts clipping. So we see we are here at 2.8% THD plus noise at 1 kHz, so everything is fine. And when I now increase it a bit more, you see then dramatically creeping up here our harmonics, and that is where, and you can see it here, so our THD plus noise is at 17.8, so that is because, yeah, have a look here, our second harmonic is only maybe a bit more than 10 dB under the fundamental, and that is of course then a clear sign that we are really in clipping, and yeah, a THD with 17.8 is not what we really would like to see. Just that you have an idea how it looks like on a spectrum. And yeah, when I go here down to a better, a nicer level, you see that we are then here really at, I don't know, approximately around 3%, and that is quite nice without any problem. Okay, so we can say that is really quite nice. So let's go into our TX tests right now. So we have finished our RX tests, and beside the fact that we had a little problem with FM receive, everything else was quite nice, so no problem whatsoever. So the receiver is working just fine, the audio amplifier is working just fine. We had a little problem with our S meter, which is working on S9 but not below. And well, our audio stage is just fine. So let's go into transmit testing. Okay, and let's start with output power, with HF output power. And we start on FM, and of course we should read 4 watt output, because that is a legal limit. So let's see what we can see as output power. Okay, so let's see PTT, and that is here definitely full power, so that's it. So we are not reaching the allowed 4 watt output power. So okay, that is what we know from all the radio manufacturers. So they are really carefully not to set it a little bit too high, just not to get in trouble if a radio gets checked out by the authorities. So they all put the output level a little bit below the legal limit, and that is what we clearly can see here as well. So only 3.3 watt, but well, as we see it really with all the different manufacturers, it is just fine. Okay, and the same we gonna do now on AM. And first of all, let's see what the dead key is. And that here is the dead key, so that is nearly the same what we have seen on FM. But now we are switching on our generator. I have the audio generator connected to the input with 1 kHz. So I switch it on. And now I increase the microphone gain. So that is the mic amplifier here in the radio. And you see with a constant tone of 1 kilohertz, right, we can reach 13, it is 13 watt in the peaks. So that is quite nice. And now the same on AM, but here with a microphone. And just to see if I can push it any more with my voice, which happens very easily. So let's see what we can read then. Okay, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. Hola, check, 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 check. Audio, audio, audio. And yes, that is clearly to see we are able to push it up to a peak of 22 watt, 22 watt in AM. Mic amplifier is completely to the maximum, so that means clockwise to the maximum. And here we have peaks, you can already see it. We have peaks up to 26 watt. So that is awesome, no problem whatsoever. Okay, and radio now is on SSB upper sideband, and let's see what we can do there. Dead key should be zero, let me check it. Yeah. Yeah, dead key is no output, which is good. And now let's check it with my voice. 1, 2, 1, 2. Check, check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Hola. 1, 2, 1, 2. Check, 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 check. And you see it is 1, 2, 1, 2. It is 10 watt output power. And that might be just for the reason that there is only 12 watt output power allowed on SSB, and that might be the reason why we do not see anymore. So it is the same as we have seen it with FM. So they stay below 12 watt just to pass all tests which might be happening in the market by the authority, and that is the reason why they do not go over this approximately 10.5 watt maximum. So that is clear. I didn't expect it really different. Okay, so what we gonna check next is our deviation on FM, and well, we should be able to get it up to 2 kilohertz. 2 kilohertz would be okay. And let's see what it is when we push it as max as possible. And that it is. So I can read 1 point, so it is a lower scale, so scale end is 3 kilohertz, and so that is where we have to read our value. Means that it is 1.85. So I definitely expect it to be lower. I mean, we can increase it just a little bit. So it is, we are in tolerance if we put it on a level of, let me say, 2.1 kilohertz, maybe maximum 2.2, but that is a limit. But I have seen new radios which much lower deviation, so I didn't expect it to be at 1.85, but anyways, it is too low, and it needs to be improved. just a little bit to get a nice and clear, loud modulation. So that is what we are looking for. So therefore, a little bit. Next is let's check the frequency stability, and not only frequency stability, we also want to check if it is on frequency. So radio for instance is now set to 27.205 megahertz, and that is what we would like to read. Now I go on transmit, and what we can see is 27.204.922. So that means roughly 80 hertz too low. So so our frequency needs to be adjusted just a little bit. I mean, we will not recognize it on FM. So for FM, this frequency delta is just fine, and it is definitely within the legal limits. Let's check it on SSB, and there it is much more important to be more or less spot on. Okay, and radio set to upper sideband. We are on the same frequency, 205, sorry. So that means on upper sideband with 1 kilohertz test tone, we should read 27.206 on our counter. So let's see. And so that is what I expected. So we are approximately 90 hertz off. So we are too low in frequency, and that is something which really needs to get adjusted a little bit, because you already can hear 30 hertz. If you are 30 hertz off, then you can already hear it. And here, as I said, 206 should be the reading, and what we see is 906. So this is a delta of approximately 90 hertz, so it is too low, and that is something what you definitely hear on a band. So therefore, now that is a little bit disappointing, that a new radio, and it is warmed up quite a while right now, so it is not because it is too cold or such. So you know, that is for my from my point of view, this is simply too much. So 90 hertz off, no, not good. Okay, so let's check the spectrum, and first of all, let's look out for spears. Transmitter is set still to 27.205, and that here is our carrier, and we have our marker here on our carrier, which is 27.204, and you can see here as well our delta, but anyway, so that is not the problem. We just interested in a delta, and delta should be read here. Let me check. Here we are, and so our specifications are telling us that spears should be always better than 50 dB under carrier, so dBc. What we find here is that our spears are below 50, and that means it is good. So specs. So radio is in specs as long we are talking about spears. So that is fine. So here our left spears, which is 1 megahertz below our carrier. So our span is right now 10 megahertz. So that means every division here is 1 megahertz. So we can say that this spears is approximately 1 megahertz away from our carrier. And therefore, we can say with -52 or such, we are definitely within specifications. Yeah, this here is our harmonic viewer, and what we can see here is that the second harmonic is at -62 dBc. This would be good if it is a short wave, if it would be a short wave ham radio, because there we have the specification that it needs to be -40 dB under carrier. But as this is here a CB radio, we have to check it out a little bit different, because we need to check for -52 dBm, and that is rather different to dBc. Okay, and yeah, I have to correct myself. So our harmonic needs to be at -36 dBm. So sorry, it was not -54 or 55 2. So that was wrong. Our requirements are -36 dBm for our harmonics. And I've set here our marker already to 54.4, yeah, approximately 4.1, which would be the first harmonic, considering that our fundamental is 27.205, and this here should be or have to be at -36 dBm to be within specs. Okay, let's go in transmit and let's see what we find. And here we are. So here at the left end here, that is our fundamental with approximately 36 dBm output power, which is representing 4 watt. And this here is our first harmonic. And as you can see, our first harmonic is sitting or first harmonic or second harmonic, it depends how you have learned it. In any case, this here is our first distortion tone, whatever you want to call it. And this should sit at -36 dBm. And have a look. So it is sitting on -24. And that means there is really missing 10 dB. So the harmonic is simply too high. So the suppression for harmonics is not sufficient, and therefore the radio is really out of spec. So, that was really not expected. And let us remind this value -25 dBm. Let's double check. Okay, and let's double check it. So this is here our output power sitting at 36.5, let me say 36.5 dBm, okay? And yeah, let's see our normal harmonic viewer, which is this here, and let's see what we can find here. So that is now very important because we just do now the little mass here. So that is approximately, best case, minus 63. Let us say 63. And if we do simply the mass here of 36 dBm, and is plus 36 minus 64 dB, and that is minus 28, and that is now minus 28 dBm in best case. But our requirement, let me double check, means minus 36, and that still means that we 8 dB off, so we are not really fulfilling the legal requirements of suppressing our harmonics in the required way. And yeah, that is really a little bit I don't really understand, because always in the past Albrecht was really the best radio if it comes to harmonic suppression, and now we are really so far off. So minus 28 dBm is what we find if we do it here the classic way. And once again, if we see this here, so this is a fundamental, and our they call it, that is first harmonic, second harmonic, so that is how they do it here. Okay, so our second harmonic is sitting at minus 60, yeah, let me say minus 63, which would even be a little bit less. And if we calculate what I have done here, 36 minus 64, because yeah, our second harmonic is sitting 63 dB under carrier, then if we doing this little mass, that means it is a carrier here, or a tone which is sitting on minus 28 dBm. And as long our requirements are saying that the second harmonic has to be at minus 36 dBm, we can say that we are off 8 dB. And that means once again the harmonic suppression is not sufficient and is not fulfilling the legal requirements. And I repeat it that often, because I've never seen such on Albrecht radio. So especially Albrecht always was in spec when it comes to harmonic. And so that is really disappointing. Okay, and last test, let's check for frequency stability when we key the carrier. So it is now in real-time mode, and so we see when we key it if it is directly on frequency, or if it is unstable, and if it is jumping around a little bit. And what we can say so far is that when I'm keying the carrier, it is more or less directly on frequency without any problems. But if I release the PTT, you see that we then have some energy working around here. So you can see it here. I mean, it is not dramatic because, okay, so we are here at 36 dBm, which is 4 watt, and you can see peaks here, which are around 10. Yeah, the peak here must be at 12 dBm round. So, and 12 dBm is something like 20 milliwatt, approximately 13 dBm is approximately 20 milliwatt, which where we have for a second, or not a second, for a very short moment when we release the key, the PTT, we see that we have here some peaks. But yeah, other than that, the frequency is given and it is not drifting. So in the moment when we press the PTT, everything is fine. Just when we release it, we see here some little minor problems, but yeah, 20 milliwatt for a short time. I do not have the specs for that, but I would say that is good. So it is really important that when you key the radio, that it is just on frequency, and that is definitely given. All right, so we are more or less at the end of our test. I mean, we could do some more lab tests, but I think this will already give us an overview. I have already performed an over-the-air test, and well, we found over the air that the modulation on FM is should be a bit louder, so therefore we know that the deviation needs to be readjusted a little bit, not much, just a little bit. But on the other hand, the modulation is not crisp and clear. It is a little bit so the low frequencies are dominant, so there are not enough high frequencies when you talk into the original microphone. So yeah, therefore you need another microphone because it sounds too dumb on the air. That is what we found. Well, to summarize, it is really a nice looking radio. It is really a nice a nice retro style radio, and that is quite nice. But we have some issues, more or less minor issues, which can definitely be aligned. But overall, I have to say I'm not really satisfied with the quality which comes out of the factory. And I mean, I have tested some more Albrecht radios in the past, and The radios I've tested in the past was much more on specs, and was the quality, how the radio left the factory, was simply better. And I'm a little bit I'm really a little bit disappointed on what we have seen here. So maybe this is now the first batch which is on the market after the delay. So maybe that they will improve it a little bit, but I'm not really happy. So I don't know radios from Albrecht with this behavior. So really a little bit disappointing. But anyways, it is a nice radio. I'm sure that they will listen to their customers, and I'm sure that they will improve it. So then it will definitely be a real nice radio. Now it needs a realignment, and then it is a fantastic radio. Okay, well, that's it for today. If you like this little review, this first out of the box, first batch radio, if you like it, please give me a big thumb up, and leave your comments below this video, and bye, and catch you next time. 0.3, which we have approximately here, and you see now the radio is only able to peak maybe 8 dB synod, so maybe less. So you see that is a little bit unexpected. I thought that it is really in spec, but it does not really look like this. So that is a little bit disappointing. I'm testing on channel 80, which is 26.955 megahertz. So that is the frequency, and that is right in the middle of the entire band. So therefore, let us check the figures. If I move into, let me go to channel 18, maybe. So that is 27.175 megahertz, and now we are on 27.175. And it is not channel dependent, obviously. So even with this changed frequency, we have still not our expected synod value. So okay, let me go up to channel 40, just in case, which is 27.405 megahertz. And let me hear. Yeah, we have our signal. So now we are at the band edge of the upper channel. So 27.405 is the highest available CB radio frequency, and even there we are not able to meet the 0.3 microvolts, which is 300 nanovolt, by the way. But anyways, the radio is not able to really fulfill this figure. So that is really disappointing. But anyways, there is another value which is given, and that is telling us that the, how do they call it, hang on, So the minimum signal which could be read should be -135 dBm. So let me switch it back to dBm. Let me hear our speaker, and yeah, we can hear the tone for sure. Now let me go to 135, and you already hear, maybe here with -122 you are able to read the signal, but going down here to 35, so that is simply not true. There we only have static, and we definitely do not see a signal at all. So that is definitely not true. And that is here the level where we can hear a little bit in the background, and that is very easy to see here on that is very simple to see here on the spectrum as well. So this here is an NF spectrum, and you see here this is a 1 kHz peak, and if I go down to 135 as they are claiming in the manual, you do not see nothing. So you only see noise. So that is a horrible signal to noise level. There is no signal anymore. And when I now go back here to the point, and now you see the signal is coming up here out of the noise. And of course, when I go up, you definitely see the signal, and you see the improving signal to noise ratio. And yeah, let me go here maybe up to -73. So now I'm back to -73, which is an S9 level, and you really see a very much improved signal to noise ratio. And yeah, so the noise is down, and you definitely see our signal. And again, if I go here back to to 12 dB Synet, which is approximately here, you see, of course, we have a reduced signal to noise ratio, that is sure. And this here, by the way, are the distortions. So that are the harmonic distortions, which you can see here. And so therefore, the radio is not really giving us the figures which are written down in the documentation. So there, I have to say, the radio is out of spec. Well, now I'm testing on SSB, a radio set to upper sideband, and here we have a different situation. So what you can find here with 250 nanovolt, so we are already peaking 17 dB Synet, which is better than the specs. So we could go down, let me say, to 10, because that is what they are claiming. And let me remind you, the Synet value is not only signal to noise, but it is also the distortion. And if with the Synet level we are much better than the specs, then it is really good, because here the specs are only talking about signal to noise. And you see with 10 dB Synet, maybe a bit better, but anyways, we are down to 119 nanovolt, and that is completely different in this regards, and it is from that perspective it is really good, so we can't complain. So this radio is definitely better on SSB receive than on FM. So something is wrong with FM receive. Maybe that the alignment is not really good, so that the radio needs to be realigned. But you know, that is not what I would expect from a radio like this, because the majority of us are not able to realign a radio, because that really requires some knowledge and some lab equipment. So that is really disappointing, and these radios are most likely used on FM. So I would say for more than 90% these radios are used on FM, and therefore once again that is disappointing. But on the other hand, here on SSB our receiver is working better than in the specs, and that is on the other hand very much in the specs and even better. Yeah, just to show you the spectrum display as well, so we are still at down at 119 nanovolt, which is really very low, so that is minus 125.5 dBm, so that is really a low level. And here we can clearly see our fundamental radio is slightly off, so normally we should read here 1 kilohertz, but it is 1.021, so radio is 21 hertz off. So my Rohde & Schwarz is reporting exactly the same. So our frequency is off a little bit, but that is something we're going to check later on transmit, how far it is off on transmit. And you can see here my signal to noise level. So signal to noise is still 12.5, and once again that is not the synod what we are reading here, so that is really signal to noise, and we are above the required 10 dB. So we can clearly say that our SSB receiver is nice and sensitive, and it is really working as it should. Okay, radio is back to FM, and I'm now interested in our filter width. So this will be the filter width measurement, so to identify how wide or narrow our IF filter is here for FM. And yeah, therefore let me start the routine to be able to measure our filter width. And now radio has started the routine, and we should read here if it is ready. We should see the filter width, and we should see the delta from the middle of the filter. And you see radio is working, and here we are. So our filter width is 8.8 kilohertz, and we are 400 hertz off from the middle, so that is not too bad. And this filter is fine, so that is approximately 9 kilohertz width, so that is more than good for our 10 kilohertz steps we have here with our CB channels. So I'm quite satisfied here with 8.8 kilohertz, and as well with our delta from the middle of the IF filter. So that is good, and so this test is passed. Okay, radio is back to SSB upper sideband, And I'm now interested what the filter width will be on SSB. So now the test procedure is a bit different. So we need to find the -6 dB point at the edges of the filter. So at the lower end and at the upper end. And therefore I go and will change then here the frequency, and so the tone will be different. So for the moment in time we are right more or less in the middle of our filter. And what I'm gonna do is I'm checking where we have our -6 dB point, and let me show you how I'm gonna do this. Okay, so therefore I put my little audio analyzer here to the radio, and you can still hear the tone, which should be 1 kilohertz. So we can check it, by the way. And you see here we have again our 21 hertz off, so that is what we have already seen on our spectrum. Anyways, so with this 1 kilohertz we see that we have 426 millivolt. And so that is not so important. More important is to say that this level will be 0, right? 0 dB. And therefore we simply go here to 0, and I tell the meter that this will be 0, and you see now the meter has zeroed the value. So now we are reading 0.00. So these two figures are behind the dot is fine. Maybe I simply reduce the digits to this here, then it is easier to see. And now I'm gonna change my generator frequency, and while changing the generator frequency we are moving within our passband filter, and I want to see the edges of the passband filter, and we write down then the frequencies which are corresponding with our -6 dB, and then we find the lower end and we find the upper end of our curve. And so then we can calculate with my voice, which happens very easily. So let's see what we can read then. Okay, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. Hola, check, 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 check. Audio, audio, audio. And yes, that is clearly to see. We are able to push it up to a peak of 22 watt, 22 watt in AM. Mic amplifier is completely to the maximum, so that means clockwise to the maximum. And here we have peaks, you can already see it. We have peaks up to 26 watt, so that is awesome, no problem whatsoever. Okay, and radio now is on SSB upper sideband, and let's see what we can do there. Dead key should be 0, let me check it. Yeah. Yeah, dead key is no output, which is good. And now let's check it with my voice. 1, 2, 1, 2. Check, check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Hola. 1, 2, 1, 2. Check, 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 check. And you see it is 1, 2, 1, 2. It is 10 watt output power. And that might be just for the reason that there is only 12 watt output power allowed on SSB, and that might be the reason why we do not see anymore. So it is the same as we have seen it with FM. So they stay below 12 watt just to pass all tests which might be happening in the market by the authority, and that is the reason why they do not go over this approximately 10.5 watt maximum. So that is clear. I didn't expect it really different. Okay, so what we are gonna check next is our deviation on FM, and well, we should be able to get it up to 2 kilohertz. 2 kilohertz would be okay. And let's see what it is when we push it as max as possible. And that it is. So I can read 1 point. So it is a lower scale. So scale end is 3 kilohertz, and so that is where we have to read our value. Means that it is 1.85. So I definitely expect it to be lower. I mean, we can increase it just a little bit. So it is, we are in tolerance if we put it on a level of, let me say, 2.1 kilohertz, maybe maximum 2.2, but that is a limit. But I have seen new radios which much lower deviation. So I didn't expect it to be at 1.85, but anyways, it is too low, and it needs to be improved just a little bit to get a nice and clear loud modulation. So that is what we are looking for. So therefore, yeah, a little bit. Yeah, next is let's check the frequency stability, and not only frequency stability, we also want to check if it is on frequency. So radio for instance is now set to 27205 megahertz, and that is what we would like to read. Now I go on transmit, and what we can see is 27204922. So that means roughly 80 hertz too low. So so our frequency needs to be adjusted just a little bit. I mean, we will not recognize it on FM. So for FM, this frequency delta is just fine, and it is definitely within the legal limits. But let's check it on SSB, and there it is much more important to be more or less spot on, okay? Okay, and radio set to upper sideband. We are on the same frequency, 205, sorry. So that means on upper sideband with 1 kilohertz test tone, we should read 27206 on our counter. So let's see. And yeah, so that is what I expected. So we are approximately 90 hertz off. So we are too low in frequency, And that is something which really needs to get adjusted a little bit, because you already can hear 30 hertz. If you're 30 hertz off, then you can already hear it. And here, as I said, 206 should be the reading. And what we see is 906. So this is a delta of approximately 90 hertz. So it is too low, and that is something what you definitely hear on a band. So therefore, now that is a little bit disappointing, that a new radio, and it is warmed up quite a while right now, so it is not because it is too cold or such. So you know, that is for my from my point of view, this is simply too much. So 90 hertz off, no, not good. Okay, so let's check the spectrum, and first of all, let's look out for spears. Transmitter is set or is set still to 27205, and that here is our carrier, and we have our marker here on our carrier, which is 27204, and you can see here as well our delta. But anyway, so that is not the problem. We just interested in a delta, and delta should be read here. Let me check. Yeah, here we are. And so our specifications are telling us that spears should be always better than 50 dB under carrier, so dBc. What we find here is that our spears are below 50, and that means it is good. So specs, so radio is in specs as long we are talking about spears, so that is fine. So here our left spears, which is 1 megahertz below our carrier, so our span is right now 10 megahertz. So that means every division here is 1 megahertz, so we can say that this spears is approximately 1 megahertz away from our carrier, and therefore we can say with minus 52 or such, we are definitely within specifications. Yeah, this here is our harmonic viewer, and what we can see here is that the second harmonic is at minus 62 dBc. This would be good if it is a short wave, if it would be a short wave ham radio, because there we have the specification that it needs to be minus 40 dB under carrier. But as this is here a CB radio, we have to check it out a little bit different, because we need to check for minus 52 dBm, and that is rather different to dBc. Okay, and yeah, I have to correct myself. So our harmonic needs to be at minus 36 dBm. So sorry, it was not minus 40, 54 or 40, 55, 2. So that was wrong. Our requirements are minus 36 dBm for our harmonics. And I've set here our marker already to 54.4, yeah, approximately 4-1, which would be the first harmonic, considering that our fundamental is 27.205, and this here should be or have to be at minus 36 dBm to be within specs. Okay, let's go in transmit and let's see what we find. And here we are. So here at the left end here, that is our fundamental with approximately 36 dBm output power, which is representing 4 watt. And this here is our first harmonic. And as you can see, our first harmonic is sitting or first harmonic or second harmonic, it depends how you have learned it. In any case, this here is our first distortion tone, whatever you want to call it. And this should sit at minus 36 dBm. And have a look. So it is sitting on minus 24. And that means there is really missing 10 dB. So the harmonic is simply too high. So the suppression for harmonics is not sufficient, and therefore the radio is really out of spec. So, that was really not expected. And let us remind this value minus, yeah, let me say minus 25 dBm. Let's double check. Okay, and let's double check it. So this is here our output power sitting at 36.5, let me say 36.5 dBm. Okay. And yeah, let's see our normal harmonic viewer, which is this here. And let's see what we can find here. So that is now very important because we just do now the little mass here. So that is approximately, best case, minus 63. Let us say 63. And if we do simply the mass here of 36 dBm and is plus 36 minus 64 dB. And that is minus 28, and that is now minus 28 dBm in best case. But our requirement, let me double check, means minus 36. And that still means that we 8 dB off. So we are not really fulfilling the legal requirements of suppressing our harmonics in the required way. And
hi, greetings from TRX Bench. Do you like classic radios like me? All the old styles, these radios with flair and with a kind of soul, like the Legions, maybe a Cobra GTL 148 or the Cobra GTL 2000, or maybe European one, Grundig CBH100 or Kaiser or what have we. So these radios are great, and that was the time of CB radios in general. Well, but these days there are retro style radios on the market already. And now, if you like radios like this, we have a new star here, and that is the new Albrecht AE7500. So this radio is really claiming to be a modern radio in a real nice vintage style. And that is what we want to look over today. We want to check if this radio is promising too much, or if this really could be a successor of all the Cobras or Heffy on the market. So let's right go onto the bench and let's see what this radio is, shall we? And this radio was already announced last year, but they had some difficulties and they were obviously not able to ship, but now they are available and you really can buy them. And yeah, if you right look here onto the box, you find the information. It is a CB radio or an amateur radio. And if we look onto this here, you see it can be prepared as a CB radio or as amateur radio. And that is a kind of really nice construction. So this radio has really a broad or a wide use. So that is really nice. And well, so this radio seems to be, or could be a hero. And yeah, so therefore we perform some lab tests today, and we want to see how this radio really performs. And yeah, I'm really excited, and let's right go into the box opening, and after that we directly start with our lab tests and see how this radio performs. Okay, so let's see what we have here in the box. And oh, that is tight. I can't really get it out. Oh, very, very tight. So, not so easy. But finally, here it is. Okay. So we have our user manual, for sure. So this is in German, English, France, Italian, and in Spanish. Very nice. And yeah, we have here our car installation kit. And this is as well what you need to put it in your car. And of course, have a look. So here we have the new Albrecht AE7500. So this, you know, I can't help myself, but I really like this design. So that is really, really, that is a burner. Okay, so what do we have else? So somewhere we should have a mic. And of course, here is our microphone. And it looks like the standard microphones they have already very long in their portfolio, so that is nothing special, but they are
not too bad, and here's our power cord. So that is what we have in the box. Okay, and first impression here, the build quality seems to be good. So everything looks quite nice, and all the switches and pots are working just fine, so you do not have the feeling that it is a kind of sheep. Here the pressing points are okay as well, and the finish is okay. Maybe here a little bit a damage on the... No, it's no damage, it was just a bit dirt. So everything seems to be fine, and well, we have here a label, so it must have been a quality check and telling us passed on RX and TX. Okay, we have here a very nice heat sink. I mean, if it is used as amateur radio, so this radio is putting out, I don't know, we will find it out, 30 watt or so, and of course therefore you need a bigger heat sink, so maybe that is not sufficient enough, so maybe that you better have a fan additional if you run this radio as amateur radio. And yeah, then we have of course an external speaker jack, and we have a key jack, and of course our antenna connector, and here our power cord. And we have here a sticker which is telling us how to adjust all the different how to access the different country codes, and you see we really have here different settings. That is because we have different laws in the different countries in Europe, so therefore you really need to set your radio to the legal setting which is valid in your country, and therefore we have all these settings, and this sticker is telling how to access and how to adjust it. And of course it is an AM, FM and SSB shortwave radio, and yeah, so that is what you need if you want to take part in the game. But now let us connect it to the power supply. Let's fire it up and let's see how it looks like. Okay, so let's fire the radio up and let's see how it looks like. So here we are. Very nice blue display. So let's see if it is already the European setting with 80 channels, and yes it is, so this is already set to D4, so that is what the manual is telling us, and yeah, very nice. So that is what we have. Looks really, really nice, no doubt. Okay, and well, you know, basically, this radio looks very similar to the Albrecht Ultraforce. So the only thing must be that they changed the electronic design. Maybe that they improved the quality, but I presume it is much more for reducing costs to produce these radios cheaper. So that is most likely the the target they have, and that is the aim to reduce costs. So that is what it is all about all the time with new consumer electronic. But as I already said, it looks really very similar to the old Albrecht UltraForce. Yeah, just to compare it a little bit. So this is here the Ultra or UltraForce. So that is a former model, and design-wise, it is really very, very similar. So they changed a little bit the functions of here our buttons. So for instance, this here, you can switch to SWR, to shortwave and such, and that is different with the new 7500. So there we have only the automatic squelch switch sitting, but other than that it is very much similar. And when we go through the different pictures, so we recognize that it is really it is almost the same radio. So the difference only can be with the electronic circuit design. So that is all what I can imagine, but we will find out. Well, the radio is really equipped with almost everything what has been done in the past to the old Cobras with mods. So for instance, I mean, it is not important, but well, it is like that is a Roger beep, so you can switch on and off a Roger beep, and you can change the backlight color, so to the color you really like. You can switch it off as well, and you know, that is very much what has been done in the past with modifications. We have seen a lot of nice Cobras which got a new background illumination, and that makes it a little bit individual, and that is already built in. And as well, you can switch on and off the beep, for instance, and you can see it here with this icon on the right hand side. So that is all all be accessed via program. And Roger beep, so that is indicated here. So, and that is again the backlight. So you see a lot of stuff. So it is really loaded with a lot of stuff, this radio. Of course, there are as well some nice functions like this LCR, which is last channel recall. So that is sometimes very convenient. And this radio has also an echo mod, so that has been done, or talk back, for instance here. 1 2, let me check it. 1 2 1 2 1 2. So you see we have a talk back function already included, and that is what has been implemented in the past with all the Cobras. You already recognize I really love the old Cobras, so therefore, you know, that is really nice. And you have also, that is a clarifier, and you have a delay. I don't know if we can hear the delay here on the talkback as well. No, not really, but it is definitely to be heard on the band. And we have a tone adjustment, and here our output power adjustment, and that Yeah, that is squelch for sure. Here we have a RF gain port, and yeah, that is mic gain. So we can adjust the mic gain, and this here is our automatic squelch, and we can switch it off, and we can switch to PA. But therefore, you definitely need an external speaker. Then you can switch the radio to a power amplifier. So that is an audio power amplifier, I believe. And yeah, that is that was present in old radios as well. So that is nothing new. The echo switch is here, and here is a mod switch. So that is for our filter whiz. Okay, so let me start and let me go down with the frequency. And you already see that the dBs are falling. And as I said, I'm interested in the minus 6 dB point. I have to go slowly because I'm already approaching my 6 dB level. And here we are. So let's see what we have there. So that is 27. 205. Let me write down 205.3 maybe. So that is the lower frequency. And now we have to go the other way around. So we go up, and we will see where we have our upper end. And therefore, of course, I'm now increasing the frequency, and you can of course see that now we are already over our 27.206, and we're going up, and you see that we are already on the falling edge. So let me see. Again, we have to go slowly, right? We have to go slowly up to the point where we meet our minus 6. And that is where we meet our minus 6 dB, back here to our frequency display. And we can read 27.207.91 megahertz. And now, by calculating the delta from this upper frequency and the lower frequency, we can simply determine the SSB filter width, right? Yeah, and if we do the math on these two frequencies, right, we simply find that our filter width is 2.6 kilohertz. And that is very nice, because that shows me that this radio has a dedicated filter for SSB. Because that was very often a problem in the past, because the radio manufacturers used the same filter for FM and for SSB, for the first SSB radios, CB SSB radios, which were on the market. And then we had very easily a filter width of 10 kilohertz or such, or even more. And that simply doesn't make any sense. And now, with this test, we see that now they are obviously using really SSB filter, and we have a filter width of 2.6 kilohertz, which really makes sense, because we really do not need a wider filter than this. So this is really great, and appreciate it that they are really using SSB filter. So that is really good. And maybe it is because this radio is also sold as amateur radio, because with an amateur radio it wouldn't be I don't know, so that wouldn't be simply a joke if there is not a dedicated filter, right? And just to give you an impression, so this is here our fundamental, which is at 2.934 kilohertz, which is of course our upper frequency where we are at our -6 dB level, you remember, right? And I just wanted to show you what is happening when I'm reducing here my frequency, so you can now see here our fundamental moving, and here is our 1 kilohertz point where we started off, and we went even deeper to the lower end where we have our -6 dB level, and you can again then reading this frequency, right, which is, you can really read it down here. Okay, so I'm at -8, so I have to really to go to -6 dBm, which is somewhere right here, and you see it is at 338 hertz, which makes sense. Okay, so that really makes sense, and that is more than good. So I'm quite happy with this finding. So that is quite good. So let's go ahead. Okay, next step will be our audio clipping. But first of all, let's see what the manufacturer is claiming in the datasheet, and yeah, they are claiming that the audio output will be with 2 watt into 8 ohm, maximum 7% THD, and I believe this is 7% THD plus noise. Anyways, here we have already our 2 watt, because I'm now putting the audio output into a dummy load of 8 ohm, and 8 ohm dummy load with 4 volt, which it is here already. Let me check 4 volt. We need 4 volt output power, which it is. We should have less than 7 dB, 7% THD. And that is what we want to see. And yeah, we can confirm it, because our THD is definitely below 7%, so we only have 2.6% THD, and that is what we can see here on the screen. Our sign is still very nice and clear, and even the tone is sounds really like a clean sign, so everything is fine. And well, let us now go up to the clipping. Let me do it here a little bit a different setting, and now let's go up until we reach the point, and we are already at the point, so we are really at this border where we go into the clipping, so you can definitely see it better this way here. Let me see where we can see it best, and yeah, so you definitely see that is the clipping. The clipping voltage, and it is 4.27 volt, so that means a bit about 2 watt audio output. And the clipping is reached with, let me double check here, our clipping starts so we can clearly see it, and with that we have then 4.3% THD. And when I now go ahead, you see that the THD is increasing like hell. That is what you can of course see here at our scope screen. So this is not a sign anymore, so it is more something different, but not a sign. So if I go back until the point where a sign is still a sign, and that is really 4 volt, which means 2 watt. So that is really nice. So we definitely can say that finally the audio amplifier, or let me say the entire audio stage, is really working just fine. So that is no problem whatsoever. Yeah, and just to see here the spectrum, and this is now just below the clipping where the audio amplifier starts clipping. So we see we are here at 2.8% THD plus noise at 1 kHz, so everything is fine. And when I now increase it a bit more, you see then dramatically creeping up here our harmonics, and that is where, and you can see it here, so our THD plus noise is at 17.8. so that is because, yeah, have a look here, our second harmonic is only maybe a bit more than 10 dB under the fundamental. And that is of course then a clear sign that we are really in clipping, and a THD with 17.8 is not what we really would like to see. Just that you have an idea how it looks like on a spectrum. And when I go here down to a better, a nicer level, you see that we are then here really at approximately around 3%, and that is quite nice without any problem. Okay, so we can say that is really quite nice. So let's go into our TX tests right now. So we have finished our RX tests, and beside the fact that we had a little problem with FM receive, everything else was quite nice, so no problem whatsoever. So the receiver is working just fine, the audio amplifier is working just fine. We had a little problem with our S meter, which is working on S9 but not below. And our audio stage is just fine. So let's go into transmit testing. Okay, and let's start with output power, with HF output power. And we start on FM, and of course we should read 4 watt output, because that is a legal limit. So let's see what we can see as output power. Okay, so let's see PTT, and that is here definitely full power, so that's it. So we are not reaching the allowed 4 watt output power. So, okay, that is what we know from all the radio manufacturers. So they are really carefully not to set it a little bit too high, just not to get in trouble if a radio gets checked out by the authorities. So they all put the output level a little bit below the legal limit, and that is what we clearly can see here as well. So only 3.3 watt. But well, as we see it really with all the different manufacturers, it is just fine. Okay, and the same we gonna do now on AM. And first of all, let's see what the dead key is. And that here is the dead key, so that is nearly the same what we have seen on FM, but now we are switching on our generator. I have the audio generator connected to the input with 1 kilohertz, so I switch it on, and now I increase the microphone gain, so that is the mic amplifier here in the radio. And you see, yeah, with a constant tone of 1 kilohertz, right, we can reach 13, yeah, it is 13 watt in the peaks. So that is quite nice. And now the same on AM, but here with a microphone. And just to see if I can push it any more, FM, AM, and upper and lower sideband. So that is placed here. And of course, you have here as well a noise blanker function, which can be set via the function button, and you can then read it here in the upper right top of our display. So there are really a lot of nice functions which are already implemented. So yeah, it is a full load of all nice and needful functions, and some gadgets, or however you call it. So it is really a pretty nice outfit. Yeah, and again, if you compare the Cobra 148F GTL DX, then you see this is really the radio with frequency counter and everything. So the AE7500 seems to be the successor, or try to follow this radio concept. And you see that as well, the push buttons and what have we are very, very similar to what we have here on the bench today. Yeah, and in Europe it is really important that all these radios have FM. So FM is the most used mode in Europe, so it is completely different to the US, where we still AM and SSB is used, and that is the reason why you always find the nice old Cobras, and maybe especially the Cobra 2000, GTL 2000, which has only, what means only, so this radio has AM and SSB on board. And you know, it makes sense to customize and rebuild these radios, because you can still use them. So you have your 40 channels, or what you are using in the US. And yeah, in Europe it is rather different. So we really do not have a radio which really can be used if you like to stay legal, because in the past we started with AM radios and we only had 12 channels. And yeah, so it was a kind of development over the years. And therefore, you do not really find nice old radios which are still in use, because if you once touch the radio, you really lost directly your certification, so your type approval is lost directly, so you can't use it any longer, even if you give your radio in an approved and certified radio shop from the manufacturer. Even then it is not possible to modify, for instance, an old CB radio which has only 12 channels, so you can't upgrade them to 40 channels, and you can't upgrade the former half watt legal power output to 4 watt legal power output. If you do it, you directly lose your type approval, and that is why you do not find the old nice radios in Europe. So yeah, you really need to buy a new radio if you like to get all the new features, and if you like to stay legal, then that is the only chance you have. And therefore, yeah, this radios have their right, I would call it, okay? Yeah, and you guys in the US really have a radio history, and it is worse to upgrade and to customize and to pimp your old radios. And yeah, what you see here, that is the internet site from my friend Tim from Snake Radio Customs, and you really should have a look onto his site if you are living in the US, because he is really doing an amazing job. So what he is doing to all the old radios, and it is not only to customize the front and the LCD, LED and what have he, and the background, so you can see it here by the Cobra 2000. So he is really upgrading the radio with new capacitors inside, and upgrading wires, and removing stuff which is not really working any longer after 40 years of usage or such. So I really can recommend you just visit Tim on his internet site, and he has as well a very nice YouTube channel, Snake Radio Customs, and there he shows what he is really doing to all these nice old radios. And yeah, therefore in the US you really can do your upgrade to your old radios, which is not possible in Europe if you want to stay legal. Okay, and we start now with our lab test. First of all, we start with our receiver test, and then we go through all the functions. Okay, first of all, we do a sweep test, just to get a feeling what the input impedance is. As we know, it should be around 50 ohm, or with other words, we should have always SWR from 1 to 1, which is not always given, but we want to see the radio to be more or less in the specs, so it should really not be worse than, let me say, 3 to 1. And that is what we gonna test right now. So what you hear here is a sweep, which is going over the entire band. And let's see how it looks like on the graph. Okay, and that is a sweep, and what we can see here is from this is here marker one, and it starts at 24,800, goes up to 27,582, 84 with marker two, and we see here in this area we are below, yeah, a little bit above three, but all in all it is working just fine. If I now play with my RF gain, so that is what I'm doing right now, you see we are losing receive sensitivity. Yeah, that is clear. When we play with RF gain, and you directly see how the reaction is here on the graph. So our return loss is getting worse. So that is what we very often see. And well, when I now start changing the frequency, you see that the graph is moving a little bit. No. So that is what we can see as well. Yeah, it is moving, which it should, because yeah, we want to have a changing impedance over the received frequencies, so that is working as well. I mean, this is always a very critical parameter in any kind, so it is not really easy to get real matching input for radio, for consumer radio, because to get a much better impedance, so that really means a lot of development, a lot of stuff which needs to put into radio to be really on the required impedance. But for this radio, it is all working as it should, and so we do not really have any complaints, so that is okay. Okay, so the next what we check is the S meter accuracy, and radio is set to a level of S9, and you see the reading is not too bad. So this is here our RF gain pot, and it is clear that when we change it, that we have an impact of our S meter. Now it is fully sensitive, and we see it is reading with minus 73 dBm. It is reading S9, which is fine. I just want to see how it is reacting if we read minus 85 dBm, which is this, and minus 85 dBm would mean a level of S7, and we see here a significant drop, and that means even the S7 level is not even possible to display in the right way. So that means this S meter is not really helpful, because it really drops very easily to, what is it right here, S1, which should display S7 level, and yeah, that is a little bit disappointing. Anyways, we can read a good S9 level, but beside an S9 level, you know, it is quite difficult. Okay, so next is we are interested in the sensitivity, and first of all, the SINET with minus 73 dBm is 30.6, so that is for a CB radio or a low-cost ham radio receiver, it is just okay. So we have seen even more worse receivers, which are around 24, and this is at 30 with our Zenit, and well, okay, not too bad. But I'm now interested where we are at 12 dB Zenit, because that is a level which is described in the manual, and there we should see a certain input level, which is then the sensitivity. And therefore, let me here simply reduce our input. Our input signal until we reach here 12 dB, and now this is the squelch. Squelch is back in. It's now out. Sorry, and we wanna see 12 dB, and you already hear there is now noise, which is okay. But we can go even lower. Now we are approaching our 12 dB, which is, yeah, it is jumping, which is normal because it is a very low signal right now, and I would say it is approximately 12 dB. And now I switch here my value to microvolt, because the level is given here in microvolt in our documentation. So let me double check what it is. Well, and this value is a little bit disappointing, so let me turn down here the tone. And what we can read here is 0.441 microvolt, and that is not what our documentation or specs is telling us. So let me see if I can bring it here in the front. Okay, so we are looking for FM sensitivity, and that should be better than 0.3 microvolt for 12 dB. And as you can see it here on our display, it is not 0.3, so that is even worse. So therefore, yeah, let me go down here to 0.